We are a community of possibilities. Never content with the way things are. What is possible propels us forward. We see the possibilities by knowing where. Knowing where your assets are located. Knowing where critical issues are unfolding. Knowing where your best work is being performed. Location intelligence helps you support sustainable growth. Brings a community together. And helps you explore possibilities for the future. You empower GIS intelligence to identify risks, reduce costs, share critical insights, solve problems, and work more efficiently. Together, we empower citizens to get involved, to live better lives, protect their neighborhood. These are the communities where we live, where we serve, and where we become connected. Together, we create endless possibilities. Together, we are transforming the way communities work by empowering GIS intelligence.
Thank you. It's a pleasure just looking out on this great audience. Pleasure to be here with you. Thank you for coming to Salt Lake City and welcome. You know, this is a great time of year downtown. It's, for some of you, experiencing a winter wonderland. For us, this is rather normal. I hope you'll take time to enjoy the holiday lights at historic Temple Square and downtown, and also everything that Salt Lake City has to offer. But before we get started today, I'd like to recognize the partners who are sponsors of this conference. It's really important. Our partnerships have been a long time important component of Cityworks. And so I want to recognize our silver sponsors and also our gold sponsors. I can't read all the names, we don't have time, but also we appreciate our gold sponsors and silver sponsors, and also our platinum sponsors. That's Esri, Wolpert, Power Engineers, and Trimble. Many of these partnership relationships go back to the early days of Cityworks. In fact, last night as I was at the social, the welcome social, I was just meeting people that I had known for 25 years. It was very gratifying. So please join me in expressing appreciation to all of our sponsors who helped make this conference a success, please. So as you know, recently, Cityworks became a part of the Trimble family. We're excited about this new chapter in our future. Trimble's been a longtime Cityworks friend and strategic partner. And joining the Trimble family is opening new doors, new opportunities for Cityworks. But more importantly, this is an opportunity for you, our clients, and our partners to expand the work that we do together, improving communities, because that's what we do, improving the communities we serve and we live in. Tomorrow, you'll have an opportunity to hear Steve Berglund, the president and CEO of Trimble, and we're excited about that. He will share insight on why Cityworks and Trimble are aligned so well and highlight opportunities that lie ahead for all of us. Each of us are valuable members of the Cityworks user community. And now, we're part of the Trimble community.
We start from up here, creating powerful paths to accelerate human potential. All the way down here. We are explorers of the possible, a driven collection of seekers who continually bring forth new ideas to support our customers and partners. Our mission is to advance the mission of others, those who are determined to challenge conventions. Our vision helps companies look forward, supporting their bold thinking for new products, new models of revenue, new industries, and amazing things yet to come. We are forward-thinking, but disciplined, helping businesses reach further with innovations grounded in marketplace realities. Together, we're creating solutions that improve what is and what will be. Trimble, transforming the way the world works.
That's a nice video. So many of you have heard me say that as part of Trimble, Cityworks is still Cityworks. And that's completely true. What does that mean? It means we are still an ArcGIS pure play, the ArcGIS pure play that you all have come to rely on. It also means that our pioneering GIS-centric vision is fully supported by Trimble, including expanding the Cityworks platform in Trimble. But first, and I want to make sure you hear this, first and foremost, the work we do for utility, local government, and community development is our core and will remain our core and will always be the primary focus of Cityworks. I mean, it's in our name, Cityworks. We will remain committed to Esri and empowering GIS for public asset management. It is who we are. Working with each of you as partners, we will be supporting the good work you do locally. What you do matters. It matters to the residents and businesses in your community. And it matters to you, and it matters to us. We know that the GIS-centric framework for public asset management, it helps communities become more resilient, sustainable, and safe, or as often said, smarter communities. I have a special guest who really needs no introduction. Jack graciously provided a video to welcome all of you to the Cityworks conference.
Hi, my name is Jack Dangerman, and I want to welcome all of you to the Cityworks Users Conference this year. This is a changing time for Cityworks and for Esri. We continue to both evolve our technology, but also evolve the basic way that we serve you. With the change of ownership and the merging of Cityworks into the Trimble organization, I see this as a major evolutionary step for progress for everyone, for our partnership certainly, but also for the evolution of users in a broader frame. So congratulations to all of you, Brian and his team, and also congratulations to all of the users who are doing just amazing work all across the world. Thank you.
Well, thank you to Jack and all of our friends at Esri. Yes. We have many from Esri are here today, and I know some were trapped yesterday, as others of you may have been in travel, and so I'm glad that I appreciate that everybody is here and safe. So more and more, as we travel here and elsewhere, Cityworks users seem to be everywhere. You've traveled here from all over the US, from Canada, Sweden, the Netherlands, Finland, the Kingdom of Jordan, South Africa, Australia. In total, there are over 1,200 attendees, and this represents more than 40,000 users of Cityworks around the globe. You work in a variety of organizations: public works, utilities, transportation, parks, airports, community development, city management, and so many more. We're all here to make connections, to learn, to share, and to learn from each other. We always have a tradition that really following an Esri tradition that Jack started as long as I've attended an Esri conference, and that is for us to get together and just take a few minutes and stand up and say hello, get out of our comfort zone a little bit, meet someone who you don't know, find out why they are here, and share why you are here. So let's all stand up and take that a few minutes to do that. And I'll join you. Okay, we got to get going. I hope you'll, this is really great. And I hope you'll take full advantage of the opportunities this conference provides to learn, connect, and share with Cityworks staff, clients, and partners. You know, I want to say about that, Cityworks staff, clients, and partners, you've heard me talk about the four pillars, and that really is GIS-centric, the Cityworks staff, our clients, and partners. That's what makes up this community. So take the opportunity to get to know each other. I just heard us last night, I was talking to our friends from Esri Canada, and they said, yeah, we have, you know, a client who was here and they met another organization from Georgia and another from Florida, and they have the exact same problem with their roads that we have, and they were learning from each other. That is the kind of opportunity that we have here. So take advantage of it. If you haven't already, go to your phone. You know, we all have this now, right? And go to the App Store and download the Cityworks event app. So it's a good app. It'll allow you to, you know, access all sorts of information about the conference schedule, workshops, announcements, socials. More important, there are opportunities to connect. So we hope you'll all use this and share your conference experience on social media, including using the hashtag MyCityWorks. Okay, this year marks the 50th anniversary of the Apollo moon landing. Last July, we heard a lot about the Apollo mission and the history and the impact on the world and the momentous this momentous occasion. How many of you are old enough, like me, to remember the Saturn V rocket launch? Raise your hands. Yeah, okay, there's a few, okay, not many. I was 11 years old in July 1969. I remember sleeping out in the backyard with my brother that July, and we would sleep out in the backyard in the summer and run around in the middle of the night without my mother knowing. But I remember gazing up at the moon and thinking, gosh, you know, there are people up there right now walking on the moon. As a young boy, it was quite impressive for me to contemplate that. Just 7 years earlier, President Kennedy committed the United States to achieve this monumental task and to do it boldly.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
People across the globe anticipated this historic launch. Everyone, it seemed, was glued to TVs and radios around the world. We became fixated on this giant leap for humankind. But few understood the difficulty and complexity of the mission. The Saturn V was massive, 364 feet tall, and over 6.5 million pounds when fully fueled. It required 8 million pounds of thrust to get it into orbit, and today remains the most powerful rocket ever launched. It was very elegant to look at as it sat on the tarmac at Cape Canaveral. Millions of people around the globe followed along as Charlie Duke ran through the countdown for mission control. The anticipation was overwhelming. This was one of the pinnacles of human achievement. On the morning of July 16th, 1969, Apollo 11 and its crew members, Buzz Aldrin, Michael Collins, and Neil Armstrong, were launched from the Kennedy Space Center in the Saturn V rocket. All eyes were on the Saturn V as the final countdown began. Let's relive that moment together.
T-minus 15 seconds, guidance is internal. 12, 11,
10, 9, ignition sequence starts. 6, 5, 3, 2, 1, 0, all engine running.
It still gives you chills, doesn't it? It's amazing. The rocket launched into space, the Saturn V, was just one sequence of the Apollo 11 mission. Over the course of the mission, the Saturn V rocket was discarded, leaving the lunar command and service modules. Unlike the Saturn V, the lunar and command modules did not look elegant and awe-inspiringly powerful, but they were effective. The Saturn V rocket needed to be sleek and streamlined in order to pass through the Earth's atmosphere. But the lunar module, it didn't have to be streamlined. Instead, it looked rather bug-like with its spindly legs. Some people who worked for the Apollo mission even nicknamed it Spider because of its spider-like legs. Sensors attached to those legs notified the pilots when they were within landing distance of the moon's surface. This allowed the pilots to cut the descent engines when they were close enough to safely land, protecting the module from debris that might blow up from the surface of the moon. Every aspect of the lunar module was designed for effectiveness. The same was true for the command module that brought the astronauts back to Earth. Besides guidance computers, the command module's important components were a heat shield and parachutes. From the ships, spotting crews from an aircraft carrier looked skyward for the deployed parachutes as the command module dropped from the sky and splashed down in the ocean. With the command module bobbling helplessly in the ocean, the astronauts inside had to wait for Navy divers to latch on and inflate rafts and open the door. The process was anything but elegant. In fact, it was kind of clunky. The success of the mission came down to the lunar module landing on the moon safely and the command module returning to the astronauts safely home. Both were exceptionally effective. And that brought lasting elegance for the Apollo 11 mission that inspires us even today, 50 years later. I first came across the concept of effectiveness versus elegance last July in an article about the Apollo mission in Bloomberg Businessweek. The writer, Peter Coy, reflected on the five management strategies that define the Apollo missions and how they are still valid today. Improvise, that speaks for itself. Have a clear objective. Delegate tasks appropriately, and also make sure you have leadership in place who can make critical decisions. Harness incongruence. Disagreement can lead to better solutions. But the point that stood out to me most is prioritizing effectiveness over elegance. The Apollo 11 team discarded the things that were not effective. Effectiveness was the driving factor behind every aspect of their design and planning. So what can we learn from the Apollo 11 mission? This is what I contemplated as I read that article. Well, we hear a lot today about being a smart city. Of course, I heard one pundit say, well, nobody wants to be a dumb city. We all want to be smart. We hear a lot about IoT, connected sensors, location intelligence, big data, analytics, machine learning, artificial intelligence, smart this and smart that. These are exciting examples. They're elegant, especially when we see them presented on stage, and they're enticing. But is that the only thing that defines a smart city? I don't think so. We all want to be that Saturn V rocket city. But like the Apollo 11 mission, prioritizing effectiveness first is critical to achieving lasting elegance. I believe that's what defines a smart city. That's certainly what defined smart NASA. The most successful organizations are ones who set incremental goals to improve their effectiveness, just like Apollo 11. At the Esri conference, I had the pleasure of attending multiple workshops, and one that I attended was given by Tamika Allen, the IT director of the city of Augusta, Georgia. She explained how GIS has grown from a backroom thing, that was her words, that she didn't quite understand, to now becoming the system of record. The city of Augusta has adopted GIS as the center of their data and technology strategy. It has completely changed how she views data and has changed how the city works.
Augusta, Georgia, a city of 202,000 people. We're the home of James Brown, the Godfather of Soul. We are the home of the Masters Golf Tournament. Some 55,000 to 60,000 people who are going into the gates every single day from practice rounds to the tournament itself.
All of the various departments now are utilizing Cityworks to set up special tasks and projects so that they can track what's necessary, what needs to be done prior to our guests arriving in the city of Augusta.
There's a huge influx of people during that time, and that system is kind of strained a little bit. The utilities department, we have the marshal's office, and we also have traffic engineering. I mean, they really do a lot for the Masters, and I don't think everybody knows how much work they do and how much value they bring to that particular event.
Prior to the Masters tournament, several weeks, we have to put up a lot of extra signs that normally aren't around town to help direct the patrons to where they want to go. And so we use Cityworks to help track all of the work orders, the locations of the signs. It also helps us track how many signs have gone in, how many signs we still have left to do, and how much longer we anticipate it'll take us to get it complete. So now that we have Cityworks, different crews can see what everyone's doing and where they are and where they've been. We can do what we need to do in a shorter amount of time.
My involvement with the Masters has been to make sure that the work orders and service requests that have been created are being properly assigned to that particular project. Previously, they've used just a basic spreadsheet to keep track of where all of their signage was. So I took that spreadsheet and geocoded all of their locations so they would know where those signs had to be placed.
Cityworks and ArcGIS empowers us to empower our clients so they can actually be responsible for their work, communicate via one map, that one-stop shop where they can also visualize, analyze data, and do reporting.
Cityworks and ArcGIS maps gives us the ability for live reporting. We've got the ability now to know tomorrow what we actually did today, instead of waiting for everything to get entered maybe a week or two later.
It's a good opportunity to show how much the city actually puts in preparation for the Masters and be able to capture your time, labor, and materials.
That's very good. Augusta does more with Cityworks than the sign management for the Masters, but isn't that amazing? The importance of location to pull off a world-renowned event like the Masters and the sign management that that requires. The Masters receives a lot of attention, but for the event to succeed, the city has to focus on a lot of details, big and small. And this is a great example of focusing on effectiveness that results in elegance, the Masters. Look at this graphic. It's called the State of the Data, created by the city of Sandy, Utah. When I first saw this, I looked at it for, I think, a half hour, just trying to take it all in and digest the amount of data that was being represented in this graphic, and how much processing and connections happened throughout that community. It was almost overwhelming to just understand it. And I gotta admit, I was like, wow, this is a big, Sandy City's really taking this on. However, it reminded me of Augusta in many ways. And as I began to understand Mayor Bradburn's vision and Sandy City's vision, I saw that the entire city, departments, staff, residents, businesses, are built on a GIS-centric foundation. I just thought that was really a wonderful thing, is that with that, everything flows to the GIS-centric core. Effectiveness is at the core for Sandy City, helping them create a progressive and elegant, smart community. It is professionally gratifying and really humbling to have the city where I live and where our home office is located, 15 miles south of where we are right now, realizing the benefits of GIS-centric, an idea that we started over 25 years ago. In fact, Mayor Bradburn and Kim Bell will be sharing more about Sandy City value, the value equation, in a session tomorrow. So the executive track, if you're interested in, it'll be a good presentation. When we started Cityworks, many people saw GIS as a backroom tool, much how Tamika saw it just as the maps, and then she learned it was more. They would print map books and then take them out into the field in a printed fashion. When we started Cityworks, we saw it different. We saw it differently. We saw it as the GIS as the best and most up-to-date inventory of an organization's assets to support the system of record. We believed as the technology matured, it would empower crews to take asset inventory with them out into the field. And of course, we see that today. This would make them more effective. We developed GIS-centric asset management software with the geodatabase as the asset inventory. The technology of 25 years ago, or that experience, it was more or less effective. In fact, I was talking to Damian, who will be on stage in a little bit, a little later, and of Esri, and Damian was involved in Avenue development, and that was one of the first programming languages or script languages that we used to make the first Cityworks. But some naysayers at that time dismissed Cityworks and our GIS-centric approach, but we never wavered, we never doubted. Technology improved, GIS-centric has now become a widely accepted best practice, combining effectiveness and elegance. For example, installing smart sensors on municipal garbage cans is another, the same workshop that I attended with Tamika, I saw this. Installing smart sensors on garbage cans may not seem elegant, but at the city of Raleigh, they tied the sensors to ArcGIS and Cityworks, allowing them to streamline the solid waste collection, reduce fuel consumption, and prioritize time.
The city of Raleigh manages 10,000 acres of parkland, about 30 community centers, and approximately 200 parks system-wide. So we use Cityworks to manage the cost of grounds maintenance. So we have work orders for everything we do. We started using Big Belly trash can in our park several years ago. Each morning we get an email from the Big Belly system that tells us which cans are full and which ones we need to service. We're working on enhancements with the ArcGIS Geo Server system that basically works with the Big Belly Clean software that now will convert that information into a work order. It's going to save us time in the fact that somebody doesn't have to receive the information, create the work order, and send it out to the staff in the field. They'll get the work order pretty much automatically, and they can go service the can based on the need.
We manage about 500 trash cans in the parks. Our refuse crews used to have to physically stop at each can and check whether they needed to be emptied. We serve up to 40 parks a day with 30 or 40 work orders each day.
We started using Cityworks Mobile and it really made everything work for us. With the number of work orders we have, the guys are doing it in the field. We're generating really good data, accurate data, and able to project the cost of providing the service we provide. We're now able to make data-driven decisions and track the cost.
Your traditional solid waste system, it's pretty consistent. They go out to the house every week, but ours is variable.
Our service fluctuates during the summer. We go from a very high volume on a sunny day when the park's heavily used. In the winter months, it's not as much. So we need to be able to balance our workload and anticipate the highs and lows. The GIS data for the Big Bellies helps us keep the cans serviced. People don't experience overflowing cans or service that they can't utilize. Makes the parks cleaner, keeps looking neater, and a lot more enjoyable. Helps us provide exceptional experiences for our park users.
You'll hear from Chad later and from the city of Raleigh. But you can see that small changes like this contribute to the overall efficiency and sustainability and cleanliness of our communities. And even the ducks really enjoyed that, didn't they? You see that? For any community, managing public assets and infrastructure, effectiveness is elegance. I could say effectiveness is smart. There is so much data available to us now, and so many different technology solutions, so many ways to be smart. Sometimes it can feel overwhelming. Like me, perhaps sometimes you wonder where to start. Well, my advice is just start where you are right now. To be clear, being GIS-centric is about smart technology, using smart technology to create actionable data, to remove constraints on your organization. You'll see that throughout the demonstrations, making the data actionable off of a GIS-centric core. So regardless of where you are, you can start there. This leads to a more effective organization that can meet the demands of constituents, improving resiliency, safety, sustainability, and quality of life. It's helpful to look at this in the context of what I call the Cityworks ArcGIS continuum, the system of record, the system of engagement, the system of insight. We all want to get to the point where our decisions are driven by data, good data analytics, and we make better decisions. This is the entire objective of what we do. But right now, your organization may be focused on tracking the work you do using your GIS asset inventory. That's good. That's where Cityworks started. That's where we started with our GIS-centric approach. From this core, just like we did, step by step, you can add more capability to support better systems that help improve your community. Success grows success. Effectiveness grows elegance. Now, this next example I want you to see is the city of Escondido, California. They are using the system of record, the system of engagement, and the system of insight to attack graffiti and take back their community.
Escondido was originally part of one of the early Mexican ranchos and then incorporated in 1888. And now we're a city of about 152,000 people that our mission is to have a city that's safe, clean, and efficiently run. Eliminating graffiti is one of the ways that we can do that.
Criminal street gangs use graffiti as their way of marking what they think is their territory or their neighborhood as a warning to others to stay out of that area. And so graffiti a lot of times ends up being an indicator of the larger criminal street gang activity that's occurring in a city.
We knew we needed community engagement. We needed help, right? Cityworks GIS allows people, anybody, anywhere, to be able to report an issue, be 100% electronic. By engaging the city source, we're able to have an app that was deployed out to citizens. So any time of day, they're able to use this app to report the location of the issue, take pictures of the issue, give a description of the issue, and we can get that data in. Cityworks GIS allows us to be 100% paperless. It allows efficiencies that didn't exist before.
Before we had Cityworks, we were lucky if we got 10 a day out of each guy. Each employee's turning anywhere from 15 to 34 work orders a day. Blows my mind that we could actually capture that and move so fast and get that data inputted and through and moving on to the next ones. Because as they come in, we're doing them.
And very rarely does a tag last more than a day here in the city of Escondido. The technology that we have, we now can respond to literally thousands of tags a week. And we know exactly where they are, and we can really quickly claim our city back and discourage the taggers.
As we look at heat maps, as we look at where things are happening within the city, we can kind of track all that, and we can make better decisions. Without that data, we're just going around cleaning up graffiti.
I am very excited to see traditional city functions get brought to life by technology. the CityWorks system as I've seen it roll out from department to department, and then the things we can do in each department, it's exciting.
Escondido. What an incredible example for using GIS-centric smart technology, helping Escondido take back their town. Regardless of where you are, focus making your technology and data actionable. CityWorks and ArcGIS together provide the backbone to help you improve your operations, respond to community needs, and do good locally. We want to do good locally. Because the GIS-centric platform is open, your organization can achieve incremental improvements. You don't have to go to that continuum of CityWorks and ArcGIS and everything you see and try and do it all at once. You can make incremental improvements. So no matter where you are at on that continuum, you can make those improvements by adding to its core with smart technology, empowering what we call GIS intelligence. CityWorks and ArcGIS help you improve your operations, empower your field crews. You saw that in all these presentations. And residents, that's the system of engagement. And then support your decision-making, the system of insight. This morning, we have a lineup of special guests who will share the vision of how CityWorks and ArcGIS came together to help them empower GIS intelligence. To get us started, please join me in welcoming Becky Tamashasky to the stage.
Thank you, Brian, and thanks to all of you for being here this week. It's amazing actually being up here and looking out there and seeing how many people are here. It's pretty exciting. So as Brian mentioned, we have some special presentations today, and they've been prepared by both our clients and staff. But before we jump into those, I want to take a little bit of time and just expand on what Brian shared. I'd like to talk more about the effectiveness of GIS intelligence and what it looks like as it's scaled through your organizations. The videos that Brian shared from Raleigh, Escondido, and Augusta are all achievable examples of the effectiveness of what that vision is once GIS intelligence is embraced within your organizations. Similarly, today, each of you are already driving digital transformations in your organizations. All of you want to make your organizations more agile and adaptable, help to manage risk and compliance, to increase growth and scalability, and to manage at the same time the needs of your constituents while trying to enable innovation. So the ubiquitous term smart city is often used to describe how local governments are using technology. But at times, this effort is incomplete. So smart city strategies sometimes are lacking in a wider vision that extends beyond their actual cities. But at the same time, governments, business, and residents all start to benefit from the broader value of what Gartner has described as an intelligent urban ecosystem. And this is really just taking it to the next level, taking it up and expanding it. Because initially, smart cities, the strategies focused on developing technology that would start to provide some operational efficiencies within the organization. But moving to an intelligent urban ecosystem is about applying a lifecycle governance approach, starting to evaluate all those dynamic internal and external factors that are shaping the service strategy and providing those needs back to your constituents. So one example would just be if you think about 311 and citizen engagement systems. So many times that technology is being used, and it's great because it really provides that first level of warning in terms of the symptoms that are starting to pop up out in your infrastructure. But the real power of citizen engagement tools in 311 come into play when you're starting to take all that data that's being generated and using it for analysis, starting to identify where there's clusters of issues and how that's actually symptomatic of a larger infrastructure issue, are looking at societal issues and understanding how the calls that are coming in, the work that's being done, and the resources being applied actually relate back to the parity in terms of the service areas. So when I listen to Brian discussing the importance of operational effectiveness on an organization and how that creates elegance in the services that you're providing to the residents in your community, it reminds me of a business maturity curve. And these are representing the journey of an intelligent business ecosystem. And I want to ask, as you're here this week, just think about what effective steps can you take today to help you develop as an intelligent urban ecosystem? So I'm going to have a little bit of interaction here. By a show of hands for our clients here, how many of you would say that your Cityworks and GIS implementations today are 100% complete? They're final. Okay, so I can't see everybody, but nobody raised their hands, which is what I expected. So from talking to everybody over the years, I know that you anticipate that your implementations are never actually going to be complete. These are essentially living, breathing projects that are occurring. And GIS is more than just the location of assets on a map. It's all the information about those assets that give you that broader spatial context. It's the information about their relationships, connections, dependencies that are all taking place. And the number and type of assets that your organizations are responsible for are constantly growing and expanding, and that will only continue to happen in the future. Whereas asset management provides the details related to the life cycle of all of those assets, from the time that the first design takes place through the installation, construction, operation and maintenance, repairs that are being done, and then eventually to the retirement of those assets. All of those details and transactions that are taking place are making up your asset management strategy. But asset management, when you combine that data with smart technology, you start to create a data-focused service strategy that you can then deliver to support your constituents as well as all of your organization. So when you look at the graphic here, I imagine that you saw on that curve some idea of where your organization is today. There's something there that you can look at and decide where do you want to be and what can you do to take back to create positive results for your community. So as Brian mentioned this morning, the primary goal of that Apollo mission was to create a vehicle and a set of systematic processes that would take 3 astronauts to the moon and then return them back home safely. And so maybe your organization isn't responsible for a moon mission, but you guys are responsible for making sure that after a hurricane, critical services are returned so you have safe conditions for your residents. You're also responsible for making sure that maybe there's consistently failing roadways, and you're identifying priorities that can be used for maintenance to make sure that they're not making just an impact in their quality today, but 10 years from now. Or maybe your organizations are looking at deploying smart sensors so you can proactively start to minimize and reduce those service disruptions and main breaks at a cost savings while also increasing your level of service. No matter where you are in your current journey of asset management, data analytics and location intelligence empower you to create those exchanges to identify insights to share throughout different municipal organizations and stakeholders. Because that's a big part of the concept of the intelligent urban ecosystem. It's about that data sharing it freely and easily among departments and citizens, using it to identify those priorities. You already have the tools available today. You're here, you're Cityworks customers, that means you're also Esri customers. So between the tools provided with those two components, you already have the tools available to do the job today. And many of you are already doing that. You're accomplishing so much, and you're embedding technology throughout your organization where you can. And all this work establishes trust with the public. All these, shots that have been coming up behind me this whole time, they're just showing how all that data that's being generated from Cityworks is being embedded in Esri technology and Cityworks technology to show transparency of what's actually taking place with the resources that you're charged with as the municipal stewards. So the objective is to continually strive to create a safer, more resilient, and more sustainable community. When I was walking in this morning, I saw all those quotes on the screens from clients, and those themes were present in almost every single one. Because when you do that, people identify your community as a good place to visit, a good place to do business, and a good place to live. And Cityworks, Esri, and our business partners are dedicated to providing GIS-centric solutions to help deliver this technology within your organizations. Our partners in particular are a key component of delivering emerging technology. So you can see on the screens here some examples of our partners who are already working with 3D and ArcGIS indoors to enable collaboration with Cityworks. Because striving for effective solutions, though, it's not just limited to what's taking place with the public. Part of it is also is making sure that your internal workers have the tools that they need to be effective and resourceful. And out in the field, it isn't just a matter of the hardware and software, but also making sure that they have the data that they need. So they're not just effective, but also safe. And the advantage of having that GIS-centric framework that you already have in place with Cityworks and ArcGIS, it makes sure that there's consistent data that's being shared throughout your organization. But this also extends beyond just your organization. It's about taking it to a broader approach. Because when you extend and immerse in the importance of location intelligence, you make your solutions multi-jurisdictional. And you start to enable that collaboration with your neighboring communities and other external agencies. There's so much that's available today in terms of collaboration through cloud platforms, machine learning, data analysis, IoT tools. Just imagine if you could start using that technology and breaking down those data silos between city, county, and state lines. Imagine what that would mean in terms of the level of customer service that you could start to deploy and enable on a broader scale. You'll see this in reality in the sessions on the main stage and today and tomorrow, as well as in the breakout sessions this week. Your system of record, system of engagement, and system of insights are helping to build that central nervous system that then powers an intelligent urban ecosystem. It's always going to be evolving, and it might be a finish line that you never really reach, kind of similar to your implementations with Cityworks and the GIS, because the challenges that are being put before your organizations are always going to be emerging. There's always going to be new issues that are popping up that we can't predict today. But fortunately, at the same time, the technology and the processes and the people that are there to help you solve those challenges, they're also constantly improving and adapting. So with that, it's time to think beyond smart cities and take it to the next level and empower GIS intelligence to lead the way to help create a stronger community, state, and a nation. So with that, I'd like to kick things off with some examples of communities that are already starting to work along these methods. And I'd like to introduce White House Utility District. And White House is going to show how they've embraced this vision with a solution that combines their Esri apps along with their Cityworks technology. So their web services, webhooks, and using that technology together to enable some efficiencies and automation in what they're delivering to both their residents and the businesses that are interacting with the district. So with that, I'd like to bring to the stage Ashlyn Freeman and Carl Alexander. Yeah, yeah. Good luck, guys.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Becky. Our utility district is located in one of the fastest growing areas in the country. And over the past 5 years, almost 100 people per day have been moving into Middle Tennessee. With the district being located just north of Nashville, large residential communities and commercial developments began to move into our service area at a rapid pace. Our development process was managed with a combination of paper, spreadsheets, and emails. We required all of our request forms to be downloaded, filled out, and then either brought into the office or mailed in. And with all this expansion, it started to become overwhelming for us.
To help tackle this challenge and other challenges the district faces every day, we started our digital transformation, using GIS and GIS-centric applications as the foundation for transforming our core business processes, allowing users, staff, and customers to be able to view and submit information spatially, all in real time, all with the end goal of improving customer service, better asset management, and smarter decision making.
Esri's Survey 123 was the right tool to quickly replace all of our paper request forms for our developers and contractors, allowing us to receive their applications immediately. Digital plan submission from our engineers allows our inspectors to use Collector on their iPads to view construction plans while they're out in the field as the infrastructure is being installed. We no longer require any paper plans to be submitted for review. To make the process of going digital easier on our developers and contractors, we used ArcGIS Hub to bring all this information into one location that is easy for them to use and access.
With all of our request data now being in GIS, we're able to add it to dashboards and web mapping applications for managers and staff to use throughout the entire approval process. Then staff wanted to create their own GIS features that would replace the spreadsheets and the access databases they had to manage. Now, plat and easement data needed for projects can now be found spatially by anyone in the district. Engineering even has a GIS feature that they update when a development has been accepted. That is shared with customer service, letting them know if they can sell water meters to the developer.
So these GIS tools and external processes really helped us streamline the initial request process for developments. But once the projects have been approved and developers are ready to move forward, we need an application designed to manage this development process. Cityworks PLL and with the public access portal was the ideal solution. PLL gives us the ability to configure workflow templates with logic, assign fees based on geography, and the public access portal gives our developers, contractors, and engineers the ability to see the status of their projects, upload their plans, and pay all their fees online.
So we just shared with you how GIS has modernized our request process and improved communication with engineering and customer service. Ashlyn talked about PLL and how it's the perfect application to manage our extensive development process. But as great as these tools are, information that was created in GIS had to be manually added to Cityworks. And tasks completed in Cityworks that needed to update or create GIS features was manual as well. But now, with webhooks and Action Manager, we have a mechanism that allows Cityworks and GIS to share data, event-driven information. So now Ashlyn and I are going to show you a few examples of how webhooks and Action Managers have eliminated these manual updates, completely streamlining these business processes.
So here we have one of our PLL cases for a larger water development that is in the post-construction phase. On the right, you'll see all of our workflow tasks, and we're at the point in this project where our construction coordinators and inspectors are expecting to receive the disinfection report from our contractor. Disinfection is part of our compliance for the state of Tennessee. Once new water mains have been installed, the contractor is required to disinfect the line. To submit this information, our contractors go to our development hub site and submit the Survey 123 form.
So the hub site has everything needed for development in the district. At the top are all the request forms needed throughout the construction process. The contractor just needs to click to open up the certification of disinfection form. So here we have our Survey 123 form for the contractor to submit all of their disinfection information. Below the map is where we required them to include our PLL case number. Requiring this allows us to send all of the survey information that they submit here to that PLL case by the webhook whenever the survey is submitted.
So we're going to jump back to that PLL case and refresh it. You'll see that by that survey that was just submitted, that the received disinfection report task was completed and the review task became available as a result. This notifies our inspectors that the report has been received and it needs to be reviewed. Survey 123 gives us the ability to create a feature report that organizes all the survey data. And with the webhook, we are sending this document back and attaching it to the PLL case, making it readily available for our inspectors when they are ready to review it.
So as you can see, we have the Survey 123 form that replaced a complicated spreadsheet. And then we had PLL that we used to store, track, review, and approve this information. So we had GIS and Cityworks that really modernized our disinfection process. But with the use of webhooks, we were able to completely streamline this workflow. by taking all the information that was created in GIS and automatically updating and adding it to that PLL case. So let us show you how we're using webhooks and Action Manager to pass data from Cityworks PLL case and automatically update the GIS feature that lets everyone know a development has been accepted and it's okay for the developer to purchase water.
So in our hub site, we were able to embed the web app that customer service uses to know if they can sell water meters. Having this externalized allows the builders in the area to monitor the status of the upcoming subdivision lots. Here we have a development phase that the contractor still has a few items left to complete before we can accept the project and take ownership of the infrastructure. So the GIS feature is red, indicating meters cannot be sold. We're going to go back to the PLL case, and once the developer completes those remaining items, our construction coordinator will complete the process acceptance task. Now builders can start to purchase those water meters and start construction.
So now we're going to head back to the hub site and the Tapsdale status map. We're going to go ahead and zoom in on the map. By completing that acceptance task in Cityworks PLL, it automatically updated the status of this GIS polygon, changing the color from red to green. Now everyone can see that this project has been accepted by the district, and it's okay for the developer to purchase water meters.
So before, when requests were submitted via GIS, staff would receive an email containing all the information, and then have to go into Cityworks and update the work order or service request. And then when something was completed in Cityworks, they would then have to go find the right web map or app and update all the GIS features. Processes like this happen multiple times a day across almost all departments in the district. And as you can see, these examples show how we are automating our procedures and how the elimination of these once manual processes has improved communication and increased efficiency across the district.
Integrating your Cityworks workflows with your ArcGIS applications has always been a resource-intensive task, but it's something that staff is always asking to be done. Now the technology is available to easily connect Cityworks with your ArcGIS platform. Webhooks and Action Manager have seamlessly bridged the last gap between Cityworks and ArcGIS. Thank you.
Thank you, Carl and Ashlyn. So I think that was really exciting because if you think about what they were showing, that wasn't custom development or integration. They're using all COTS technology. So they're developing this completely sustainable approach to how they're improving the technology within their organization. So I want to add a new layer to that and talk a little bit about machine learning. I want to set a base ground here for everyone's understanding. Machine learning is a type of artificial intelligence, actually. But it's using models to teach computing systems how to perform specific tasks. And it's being developed in a way that can be applied to municipalities and real world situations. So one example is if you think about the CCTV cameras that are everywhere throughout an organization, out on the traffic zones, within buildings, being able to train computer systems to capture those images and identify certain situations, so potholes, litter, flooding within the streets, traffic accidents, and then using Cityworks web services to immediately trigger work orders to take care of those items. It's pretty cool stuff. For anybody here who knows me, my background is engineering, and I get really geeked out about this kind of stuff, so I think it's super cool. But the really cool thing is that this isn't just some kind of futuristic technology. This is a reality that's happening today and can be maximized within local government organizations. Earlier, we saw in the videos how Raleigh's using sensor technology to improve the trash removal in their parks. For Raleigh, that's just the tip of the iceberg of what they're doing. So to expand on what I just talked about, I'd like to bring to the stage Chad Foley from the City of Raleigh. Whatever it takes, 'cause I
love the adrenaline in my veins. I do whatever it takes. Good morning. This is pretty exciting. Thanks, Becky. So my name is Chad Foley. I work at the City of Raleigh in North Carolina. I've been with the city in the IT department for about 13 years, and we've had Cityworks about the same amount of time. I'd say we're very heavy users of the Cityworks platform. We've completed about 160,000 work orders last year across seven different departments and tracked about $60 million in equipment, labor, and material costs, or ELM or ELM. So at the City of Raleigh, we get real excited about two things. One is real-time data, and two is automation. Like, you can't even buy a smart an asset these days without it being smart. So how can we leverage all this data we're getting, it's real-time data, and automate some of our processes to make our services more efficient? For example, when the Big Belly smart trash bin is 80% full, automatically kick off a work order. Don't wait for somebody to complain about the room being too hot or too cold. If the HVAC or the boiler sends off an alarm, kick off a work order. So last summer, we went to the ESRI Esri conference in San Diego, and we really wanted to insert ourselves between the technical folks at Esri and the technical folks at Cityworks. The prior year, we had done a really innovative integration with the Waze traffic app, where we were creating work orders in Cityworks based on potholes, signs down, dead animals, going right into Cityworks from Waze. But we wanted to continue that momentum and that innovation. So we said, what can we do? And wouldn't it be cool if there was some sort of Cityworks widget that would allow us to take all this real-time data we're getting and create work orders in Cityworks? So the technical people from Esri worked together with the technical people from Cityworks, and within 6 months, they delivered the Cityworks connector for GeoEvent platform. Cityworks connector for GeoEvent is an out-of-the-box integration for Cityworks to create work orders from your events in GeoEvent. It works by location as well. So you can have, say, an event happen in a park polygon, and you can create a park work order. You can have an event, say, on a road and create a road work order, all in the same workflow. Our first foray into this was a simple collector app that you drop a point onto a feature layer based on some attribute, you know, create work order in Cityworks, yes, no, if yes, create the work order in Cityworks. It was great. But we thought, what else can we do with this? You know, all this real-time data, what else, you know, can we explore this connector with? So it's kind of a funny story. I have a coworker that he's a beekeeper, and he was talking about he wanted to track the number of bees going in and out of his beehive. So I said, you know, we could get a $10 Raspberry Pi camera, point it at the beehive, and count the bees with artificial intelligence coming in and out. And we laughed about it. But then a couple days later, we were having a beer after work, and he works in the transportation department, and he was bemoaning how much the city pays to hire contractors to count cars or do traffic studies. And I said, like the bees, we can count cars with these cameras and do it ourselves. So sure enough, we did a little proof of concept. We pointed our Raspberry Pi out our window at our office. And after, you know, some tinkering, we were able to count cars, identify trucks, pedestrians. It was pretty cool. So we then kind of took it to the next level with Esri at our Smart City Summit. They came and did a pilot project with us on the same thing. They took our real-time traffic video feed and process it with AI in real time, creates operation dashboards, got all kinds of interesting statistics. So, you know, really the next logical step is not just, you know, seeing and doing analysis in the video, but what kind of things can we identify that we can take action upon, leveraging this connector, creating work orders in Cityworks. So we have a ton of cameras in the city. We have 100 traffic cameras. We have plans to buy 500 more this year. We're retrofitting all of our trash trucks with cameras. We have existing CCT cameras everywhere. And so now, you know, working with our partners in these departments and just getting access to that data, we were able to, you know, do more experiments. And I'll show you one I did next, where this is some intersections in Raleigh that me and my coworkers just pieced this together. But we wanted to, you know, do another thing where we would take some sort of event and create work order in Cityworks. So we thought of another proof of concept idea of just doing like a simple litter detector. Maybe we could teach the AI model what litter looks like. So you can train these AI models to identify basically anything, any kind of object inside an image, based on audio, based on real-time video. In this example, we trained it to detect litter on a sidewalk or a bike path or a greenway. And sure enough, we build a little proof of concept. We have a 99% chance that this is cardboard, kick off a work order into Cityworks using the connector. So I really only have two kind of takeaways for today. One would be this technology, you know, it's here, it's real, we can do this. I don't know anything about AI, but the tools are out there that I can leverage them to do things that we want to do to create efficiencies. So I challenge you for the next two days or so, be thinking of what can you detect in your video or in your city that you want to take action on and create a work order in Cityworks. I'll have a session today at 1 o'clock at, I think, Ballroom D, mostly around webhooks, but thanks for your time. Whatever it takes.
Thank you, Chad. It's nice to know that we can always count on the city of Raleigh to be coming up with innovative solutions for Cityworks and ArcGIS to always keep us on our toes. And as I said earlier, this is just the beginning of what can be accomplished. I want to add another layer in here as well and now start to talk about IoT. We'd like to actually dive into how location intelligence mixed with IoT can help with those real-time critical workflows within your organizations and help you face the issues that you're struggling with today. So to discuss that in more detail, I'd like to bring to the stage George Mastakas, Vice President of Enterprise Solutions here at Cityworks, and Rami Naber, Product Manager at Trimble.
Hello. And thanks, Becky. In fact, we do have some really great things to show today related to IoT. We all know the declining health of our infrastructure is very real. In fact, if we focus on water, main breaks are becoming more and more common, and the societal impacts are massive because the resource is so vital, and in some situations, very scarce. In fact, America's water infrastructure scores a D. That sink in for a minute. And to understand the seriousness of a D, let's first see what it means by looking at a few of the main points in that grade. Mostly below standard, approaching end of service life, strong risk of failure. And if you look at the statistics, it's kind of no wonder why. A 2018 study found that there was a 27% increase in water main breaks over the previous 6 years. Each year, we experienced 240,000 main breaks at a cost of $2.6 billion to repair. The number one concern of water utilities is replacement of their aging infrastructure. And it's estimated we're going to need $1 trillion to maintain service and to expand it in the future. Oh, and by the way, it's going to take us 25 years to get there. So when we look at that D next to an A, look at the stark contrast. Excellent condition. Meets future demands. Resilient. Unfortunately, this problem will continue unless we approach it in a different way, unless we think of better ways to solve it. And so what if we could do that? What if we could get ahead of that very first urgent phone call that comes in? What if we could avoid the disruption? What if we could avoid the damage? And what if we could do that by letting the pipes themselves tell us? So I'm going to have my friend Rami here tell us how a little IoT device such as the one I'm holding here named Telog can help us do that. Rami?
Thank you, George. So the device George is holding there is a Telog fire hydrant pressure recorder. It's from our family of IoT, battery-powered IoT products that Trimble offers to support a multitude of water and wastewater asset performance monitoring applications, including monitoring things like pressure, pressure impulses, water flow, level, leakage of non-revenue water, combined and sanitary sewer overflow, pump station and lift station monitoring as well. Now, the technology is not limited to water. Many of you here also manage gas networks. The pressure recorders can be used to monitor pressure on gas pipelines as well. Also, the recorders can be connected to third-party sensors to bring the data into our platform for analysis, alarming, and reporting. So George and I will walk you through a water pressure and impulse monitoring example to illustrate how we can bring in the IoT real-time data and connect that with Cityworks and ArcGIS to assess the performance of the water distribution system, reduce infrastructure failure, and repair costs. So here I'm using the Trimble Unity remote monitoring software. It's a GIS-centric cloud and mobile software that's built on the Esri GIS platform. I log in now to Trimble Unity web app, notice the locations of all the sensors and monitoring sites on the map. The sites can also be managed from the list on the left side. We can quickly identify alarming sites by looking at the map. Here's an example of a pressure monitoring site with an active alarm on it. So let's take a look at this site and at the pressure data to identify what's going on. If we look further into the pressure details, we can view the time series pressure data and sub-second high-resolution impulses that were detected by the pressure sensor. With pressure spikes and KPIs on the graph clearly indicating abnormal pressure performance. Now, many utilities don't have good visibility into the performance of the network or the distribution system. These type of impulses, if gone unnoticed, could damage already aging pipelines, causing water main breaks and infrastructure damage. So now let's go back to the map and analyze the assets in the vicinity of that site. We can see hotspots along the pipelines indicating high frequency of historic leaks reported in that pressure zone. We can also see a PRV or pressure regulating valve in that area that's feeding this pressure zone. So now I want to send George out to inspect that PRV to determine if it's contributing to the pressure impulses or fluctuations that we're seeing that were detected by the sensor. So I can simply click on the valve on the map to select it and then create an inspection, a PRV inspection. I can fill out any required details, add some notes as well. And once I create that PRV inspection, it'll be automatically dispatched and managed through Cityworks. So George, I'm going to hand it back to you now to show us how this inspection and associated workflow is managed in Cityworks.
All right. Fantastic, Rami. Okay, so I have the inspection out in the field on my iPad, and the first thing I'd like to draw your attention to is that Rami and I are sharing the same map with the same information. Since both systems use ArcGIS as their operating platform, nothing complicated has to be done to bring them together. Okay, so from here I can open the inspection Rami created and process it. So I'll tap it. Up will come my pop-up. And my information then opens on the left. Now I'd like to hold up here for a moment and just draw your attention to something and see if you noticed it as well. Did you notice what just happened there? Yes, no? Side-by-side map. Meet the new respond. You asked us for this feature, and we are so happy to show it here at this conference, and you'll see more about it this week. But this is great because... Nice, okay. Exactly what I was hoping for. Yeah, you asked us for it, and we're happy to show it here. You're going to learn more about it, but again, no longer do you have to have your information or your map open in another browser tab or even in another browser window. You can see it right there, right next to it. And so just like the current respond, I can expand the data panel to see all the other information about that inspection. So from here, I'll continue processing it and fill out the observations, see the valve is not operational, there are no leaks, but there is corrosion, and the valve is not moving freely, and the diaphragm is damaged. I'll head over and I'll set the status to completed, and then I'll save this inspection. Awesome, okay. And now from here, I'd like to hold for a moment and draw your attention to the bottom right. You'll see that work order that was created. And one of the things I'd like to point out is my administrator configured this workflow so that when certain conditions are met in the inspection, a work order is instantly created. So all of you have access to Action Manager. This is a phenomenal tool that you could use to do this very thing. So as we carry on here, I'll continue by opening this work order. Again, I'm still out in the field on my iPad. Open that up. And it will load. And my administrator has also configured this work order with just the relevant information that I need. So I'll go through and populate the dates, populate the times as well. And when I set the resolution and also save, then flip over to the map, you'll notice that that work order is there. And this work order then becomes accessible and available to the back office in case they have any closeout procedures or anything else they need to do. Okay, so from here, I'm going to hand it back to Rami, because as you can imagine, we have all this great information streaming in from IoT, right? The little Telog devices. We have all this information coming in from the field. We have information coming in from the public as well, our customers and our constituents. And what we need is a really good way to visualize it, to organize it, to manage it. Rami?
Thanks, George. So all of this data can be shared in ArcGIS web maps. This allows us to quickly configure operations dashboards that can be shared across the organization, providing real-time situational awareness into the water network operations by combining the Esri asset information with Telog IoT real-time data, with Cityworks customer complaints and asset repair records, all in a single dashboard, single interactive dashboard. So now that George completed the inspection of that PRV and the repair activities, notice the alarm has been cleared by the pressure sensor, and it's no longer marked in red on the dashboard. So if we look again at the Trimble Unity pressure report, we can look at the pressure before and after the repair activities, clearly showing the absence of pressure impulses and fluctuations after the repair activities. So now I'll hand it back to George, who will show us how to use all of this data and information to plan ahead for capital improvement and asset repair prioritization.
Excellent. Thank you again, Rami. All right. Now then, with all this great information, let's take a look at that asset prioritization. The first thing I'd like to show is Cityworks Operational Insights. Using this tool, I can create risk scores on my pipes. And I've gone ahead and I've done that here ahead of time. And you'll note when I get there that I've applied a higher weight to certain attributes because I want some of them to count more. So as I expand this, I'm using, and scroll down here, I'm using the number of leaks with a weighting of 5. Okay, this is coming from Cityworks and it's coming from Unity. I'm using pipe pressure, which is coming from the Telog devices. I'm using pipe diameter, and I'm using install year. Now, once I've set this up, the system will calculate and assign a risk score to each pipe. When I flip to the map here, you'll see I can see the critical pipes in red, the medium severity pipes in yellow, and the healthy ones in the regular blue. Okay, so that's pretty cool. But to really understand the proportions of my data so that I can inform my action plan, I'm going to turn to ArcGIS Insights, where I have a variety of visualization options. And what I love about ArcGIS Insights is that it's very easy to use, and configuring and exploring the data is pretty fun. Kind of a geek myself. And so I'm looking at the screen here, and I see 4 views. In the upper left, I have a map of my pressure zones. Next to that, I have a graph that shows pipe material and pipe risk, those risks that we just created. Down and to the left, I can see the number of leaks based on install year. And to the right of that, I'm showing a population density graph for each pressure zone combined with the number of leaks. And so among other things, this chart helps me see the potential impact of any disruptions to residents. OK, so in the map, I can hover over one of the pie charts. You'll see it's dynamic. And I can see the pipes that are healthy in blue. And I can also see the pipes that are unhealthy. Looks like we have 311 of them in that map. Over to the right, I can interact with this chart. And as I select these different material types, you'll note that the map on the left changes. The two are tied together. You'll also notice in the bottom left, my graph changes there too, the leaks based on pipe install year. Now, one spot that I'd like to draw your attention to is that the pipes that are cast iron that are in bad shape, note what just happened to the graph down below there. It appears that between 1922 and 1934, those are the pipes that are giving us the most trouble. And that's just the beginning of what I can see. I can decide from here to do more expansive monitoring. I can enrich this information with maybe some replacement costs and inform my plan from that point. And so, going back to Albert Einstein's quote, I hope today you've seen a different way to think about this problem so that we have a chance to move that D to an A. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, George and Rami.
Thank you.
And I'd like everybody to keep in mind that what they showed is just one possibility with that solution. In this case, it was for water mains. But that same technology and configuration can be applied across a variety of infrastructure and workflows. There's a lot of flexibility there in that configuration. So we pulled in these examples today because we wanted to give you an idea of what is possible with the technology from Cityworks, ArcGIS, and our partners. But at the same time, these are all practical solutions that are available today to start changing the way business operations are being streamlined within your organizations. And that, in turn, starts to provide those benefits back to your clients, the residents within your communities. These examples also show the importance of a GIS-centric framework for public asset management. The power of the GIS can fundamentally transform the way a community operates once it's fully embraced. And for over 25 years, here at Cityworks, we have embraced the Esri platform as this system. And likewise, from the beginning, Esri has supported our approach with a GIS platform for GIS-centric public asset management. As we embrace the power of location intelligence in our organizations, we empower our staff and citizens to improve decision-making. And so to further expand on how we can empower GIS intelligence, I'd like to welcome to the stage Damian Spangrud, Director of Solutions at Esri.
Thanks, Becky. I want to talk a little this morning about how we see geographic understanding transforming this community as well as our world. GIS and mapping and geospatial infrastructure have never been so important. It's transforming aspects of, obviously, our world, but the impact it's having on the much larger community is growing day by day. It's helping organizations do their work better and to be able to grow and solve harder problems, creating real value for the community. We're seeing GIS transform organizations by interconnecting information, processes, and workflows, happening all at the same time, using location to bring together all this information. You've seen examples of that this morning. This is actually creating responsive organizations, responsive to citizens, responsive to their work orders, responsive to technology changes. It's using the power of geography to understand everything and to integrate it. Maps are fundamental to this because they engage and interconnect everyone. They provide the common language. I'm sure many of you have used maps in your day-to-day work to be able to say, no, you can use this to help understand. Let me show you on the map. But it's moving beyond that static communication into real-time awareness, bringing together the people and organizations and communities together, creating a common framework for collaborating and problem-solving using maps. GIS is increasingly taking geospatial and geospatial infrastructure to the edge, creating secure, integrated, interoperable systems that operate at all levels of the organization and all types of computing environments. This means that organizations are able to be connected to departments that are far afield, that are using their own edge computing infrastructure, that are connected to field crews, who are using real-time measurement and IoT sensors and secure communications to integrate everything together. It's really working across the organization, and as you talk about bringing stuff to the edge, it means bringing computing power, information, and infrastructure across the entire environment. But it's not just maps. What we're seeing is the growth of understanding of geospatial information is really around apps. They allow you to take the science of where everywhere, really making GIS widely available, whether that's using story maps to communicate, or dashboards, or 3D infrastructure, or web apps, or field apps. It's really the apps that are starting to take it forward. Nowadays, when you publish a map, many times you need to publish the app. The app is the experience that people will use to explore the information that you're publishing. Now, we really see that ArcGIS provides the system for managing, sharing, and applying geographic information at all scales, from individuals to teams, all the way through whole communities. And what we're really seeing, it's moving beyond the integrated workstation for a small group of people to being a platform for sharing and collaboration across the entire organization or across organizations for solving problems holistically, to bringing together all the information. Now, one of the powerful things about GIS is it integrates and abstracts all types of data. As an end user, the person you're providing your information to doesn't need to worry about where the different data sources come from, or whether this is a terrain data set, or LiDAR data set, or a tabular data set, or a point data set, or a shapefile, or wherever. It's abstracted to them because they see it just as information on a map. This creates the common language that they can share back and forth. As Brian mentioned, we really see that GIS is the platform for geospatial integration, bringing together your traditional system of record with your increasingly important system of insights, where you're starting to understand your data and think further using new tools like AI and ML to be able to look further into that data. But using the system of engagement to take the expertise that all of you have out of your department and your domain and allow the entire organization to benefit from your work, to engage not just your coworkers, but your constituents, the public, and other organizations to collaborate. Around all of this, one of the things that we're seeing is real-time measurement is coming into all of these. Whether you're storing the data as a part of your system of record, as you just saw, or you're using that to provide real-time information for engagement and communication, or you're using real-time information as part of your analytics. Real-time is becoming increasingly normal. It's what you are expected to have. Now, for all of you who may still work on individual projects, no problem. We really see GIS has to support everything from individual projects to systems of systems, where you start to interconnect your GIS and other systems, but you also interconnect multiple GIS systems around your organization or across organizations. When I talk about geospatial infrastructure, that's what I'm talking about. It's providing this infrastructure to allow people to do new things that 2, 3, 5 years ago they could not even imagine bringing together. That infrastructure of geospatial data, technology, is allowing whole new growth of ideas. But mapping is still a key part, and mapping is becoming easier. And as you look around in the IT world, you hear a lot about data visualization to bring further understanding. Well, what's one of the most powerful and longest lasting of data visualizations? It's mapping. But mapping doesn't have to be done by the expert cartographers in the back room anymore. You can bring mapping to everyone in your organizations. You can empower them to ask questions and create their own maps easily. Now, as a trained cartographer, I'm still okay with that because there's still a role for cartographers to build the base information, to build the representation that people start with. But it's also about taking GIS out of the office and across the field, whether it's tracking where the employees are, where the work orders are, or capturing data. Bringing them all together and being able to see that information is part of what you have to expect from using geospatial information. One of the big changes that we've seen in the last 5 years has been the growth of dashboards. As a communication tool, they are replacing reports, they are replacing maps in many organizations. They are the tool where people can understand the context of the map information, the charts and graphs and tables that give them the context for what they're experiencing on the chart. While many of these are real-time and dynamic, as we've seen, others of these are really much like a report. They're produced on a regular, periodic basis, whether it's once a day, once a week, once a month. These dashboards are becoming the communication tool that executives want to interact with on their device at any time, in the car, at home, to understand what's going on. Real time, as I've said, is increasingly important, not just because of the wealth of IoT sensors out there, but because of the wealth of all the data that's coming in. Now, for some people, real time is sub-second. For your people who work with parcels, real time is every couple of days. For other people, real time is every couple of weeks. What it means is being able to tap into that stream of data change, to be able to bring together the environment, the assets, the vehicles, all the sensor information, as well as all the transactional information, and pull it together to provide situational awareness, analytics, and even alerting as things go wrong. Imagery is one of the key areas that keeps transforming how people use data. As I started my career, let's just say a while back, imagery was something experts used. It was expensive, it was hard to get, it was updated irregularly, it was coarse resolution. That's not what we have today. You get imagery for anywhere in the world updated every couple of days. You get imagery for your neighborhood at 3-inch or better. You can start to use imagery in whole new ways. And imagery is important, not just what it looks like now, but what it looked like over time. Many of your communities were flown in the early 1940s as part of the agricultural USDA admissions. Over time, that data has been maintained and updated. You can peel back the layers and start to understand what did that area look like before. When looking at developments, the current map is important. The map of 15, 20, 30 years ago might even be more important to know what was there. But this data is allowing everyone to start to understand and ask questions of that data. What was there? What's the health of the vegetation now? Where is the vegetation encroaching on my infrastructure? Where is new developments? Who put in a new pool without a permit? These sort of data are allowing people to ask whole new questions within their infrastructure. One of the exciting things in the last 3-4 years has really been as the world of AI, machine learning, and deep learning have really come together and moved out of the experimental phase for researchers into operational. What can we practically do with this? Not a theoretical research project. You saw a little bit about that earlier from City of Raleigh. The potential here is phenomenal. And Esri is working to integrate spatial machine learning, AI tools into our platform. There's a huge wealth of tools out there, but they're not spatially aware. So we're able to take our spatial technology and blend it with what's out there to get the best of all worlds. So whether that's counting cars in a parking lot for retail analysis, or checking on vegetation health to look for pipeline spills, or object detection of vehicles, as you were talking about earlier, to so much more. And one of the keys for this data as we move forward, looking forward another 10, 20 years, is all the data you're currently collecting is the base for all your future decisions. So saving, maintaining the asset information for everything that happens now will transform how you can use these tools in the future to better predict what happens next. GIS is moving beyond just the analysts to bring together people, organizations, and stakeholders across communities. Using hubs, what we're seeing is citizens, academics, businesses, government, consultants, all can have a common framework to share and process information. But you can also engage the community to participate in that information. Whether it's asking the Cub Scouts to go out and map where the curb cuts are for you as part of their project, or bringing together open data sources and providing that out to the community to think of whole new ways of sharing information. It allows them to collaborate around shared interests and common goals. Now, from an Esri perspective, you know, we continue to support you. Our role in life is to make you more successful and help you do your jobs better. Right? We continue to be strong and growing. I think many of you know that we are committed to you and being engineering and science focused. From a corporate perspective, we're really involved in promoting spatial literacy, education, and we're trying to make the world a better place by using our technology to bring that forward. We're really working together within Esri and working with you, our customers and our partners, to really make a difference. Now, Esri and Cityworks have a long and very positive history. Brian and I were joking last night about when we first met, and look, he alluded to it, but we were all a little bit younger then. So we look forward to continuing this positive relationship as with Cityworks and with Trimble. We've had as extensive a relationship with Trimble as we've had with Cityworks over the past several decades. And as this change of bringing Trimble into the equation with Cityworks, I see nothing but positives, because Cityworks maintains who they are and who you've come to expect. And Trimble brings a whole new sense of energy and opportunities. While we talk about how GIS and geospatial infrastructure are making a difference, it's really about delivering value and transforming organizations. But it's important for all of you to know that technology is not enough. It's actually you. All of you are actually the critical components in making this succeed. It's your leadership, it's your vision, it's your strategy. Ultimately, it's your passion. The passion for bringing spatial understanding to the problems that you're facing. You're really essential to make a difference in your community, in your work, ultimately, in our world. And with that, I thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you, Damian. So I have to say, we are continually amazed by the innovations of our Cityworks users. Regardless of where your organization is today on the Cityworks and ArcGIS continuum, you each have unique opportunities to take something that you've seen this week and take it back to improve your systems. I really encourage you to take advantage of the sessions and examples that we have from our clients this week. I hope you just find something that inspires you to take it back and create some simple changes that will in turn create impact within your organizations. And in turn, we hope to hear feedback from you that will inspire us. I have to say, we are always surprised by some of the things we find out with how our clients are using the software. And oftentimes it starts, as Chad said, with a conversation about beekeeping over beers with a coworker one night. And next thing you know, the city of Raleigh is looking at object detection with machine learning tied into their work order system. So as you're taking it all in this week, consider the goals that you have for your organizations back home. And look at those visions, discuss, and explore with other clients that are here this week, our partners, and with us. We're here to help, and we really want to be part of helping you achieve that vision within your organizations. So at this point, I'm pleased to turn the stage back over to Brian Haslam, and it's time for one of our favorite parts of our program, our Exemplary User Awards.
Well, thank you, Becky, and thank you to everybody who helped out this morning. What a great presentation. So as you can see, so many of you are doing amazing work and creating effective solutions for your communities. Each conference, we recognize exemplary Cityworks users. Because there are so many different types of Cityworks implementations, we've identified three categories of excellence. As we name these exemplary users, please hold your applause until the end of each category. Excellence in departmental practice highlights Cityworks clients who have helped transform their departments. These clients demonstrate leadership and creativity in applying public asset management strategies to daily operations and long-term planning. So as I read your names, those who are here, please stand, they're representing your community. The award winners are the City of Arvada, Colorado, Yorba Linda Water District, California. Stay standing, stay standing. The City of Portland, Maine, and Salt Lake City Public Utilities. Please join with me in honoring these Excellence in Departmental Practice Award winners. Thank you, thank you. The Excellence in Enterprise Practice recognized clients who use Cityworks throughout their organization in a high quality manner. These clients offer great examples of how Cityworks enterprise solutions can help improve work, planning, budgeting, communication across the entire organization. The award winners are, and again, please stand, Independence Power and Light, Missouri, the City of Escondido, California, City of Kelowna, British Columbia, and the City of O'Fallon, Illinois. Great. Please join with me in honoring these. The Excellence in Online Practice recognizes, in this year, a client using Cityworks Online and tools like EURL to improve data accessibility, transparency, accountability in their community. And again, please stand, the award winner is Greenwood, Indiana. There, right there. Thank you. Now, after the break, all of you award winners, please join me up here on stage. We want to get pictures, okay? So before we go to the breakout sessions this morning and the expo hall that opens, I have one more thing I want to share. The Cityworks team is passionate about providing GIS-centric tools to help you do good locally, to help you in your everyday work. We're also passionate about giving back to our local communities. As many of you know, one organization that is near and dear to my heart is the TLC Foundation for Body-Focused Repetitive Behaviors. Body-Focused Repetitive Behaviors, BFRBs, is a term for a group of disorders that includes hair pulling, skin picking, and nail biting. As I've talked about this over the years, there have been about 32 people who have come to me out of our audience, out of our users, who have said, I have a family member or someone close to me who suffers from this. I didn't know it had a name. That's part of the reason that we do this. BFRBs are complex, and they're really misunderstood. Because they lack awareness and information about the reasons for BFRBs, people who suffer from the disorder and those close to them that provide support often don't know where to turn and help. The TLC Foundation for Body-Focused Repetitive Behaviors is a donor-supported, nonprofit organization devoted to ending the suffering and shame caused by BFRBs. I have dealt with this in my own family. I currently serve as the board president of the TLC Foundation on a voluntary basis. as part of our conference. As we've done in the past, we're very excited to host a silent auction fundraiser to support the TLC Foundation. Many of our business partners and others have contributed. And when you go over there in that area of our expo hall, you know, please look at, as you do the silent auction, it recognizes those who have contributed. And thank you for your contributions. This year, our goal is to raise $5,000. The silent auction opens today at 10:30 a.m. and closes tomorrow at 1 p.m. It's a fun thing to do. There's a lot of interesting and nice gifts over there. So please stop by. You might even find something that helps you in your holiday gift list. This is the time of year for gathering with friends and family, and that's exactly who you all are to me and to us at Cityworks. So many of you, we have just many years of experiences, and those of you that are new, we welcome you into the Cityworks, our Cityworks community, our Cityworks family. So I'm grateful that you are able to be here in person to connect with us, to share ideas with us, to connect and share ideas with each other of how you and we together as partners can better, with our common vision, can improve the communities where we all live. And we have one final surprise. Now, some of you, how many here are here for the first time? Just raise your hand. Oh, that's, look at that number. That's really great. Glad to have you here. We have since we're such a forward-looking software company, we have our own mascot, Cityworks Sam. You may have seen pictures of Cityworks Sam. And when I first proposed the idea of a mascot, some of our staff probably thought I had lost it. And but what is Sam? Why do we have Sam? Because Sam represents you. Cityworks Sam is a city worker. And Cityworks Sam is here, and he also helps us in our various community outreach. And so he's here, and he has a gift to give to all of you, and they'll be in, along with his helpers. So before I bring Sam out, I just want to remind you of a few things. The expo hall opens, our sessions start all at 10:30, and we also have a social tonight at 5:30, that's a lot of fun, so please come to that. And I know some of you are wanting to go to the Utah Jazz and the Lakers game. You'll just a few blocks away, you'll be able to easily come to the social and still get there. And there's plenty of food in the arena if you're still hungry, but we have food at the social. So please come to our social and enjoy it. And so now, without any more, Sam, come on out. Yeah, you better watch out. You better not. Here's Sam. You better not. Okay. I'm telling you why. And Cindy is going to bring out some candy canes for Sam, and then we'll dismiss, and please get a candy cane from Sam if you like, or Sam's helpers who are throughout. So thank you all.